Norbert Wiener went to college at age 11, obtained his bachelor's at 14, his PhD from Harvard at 18. Before Norbert Wiener became known as the founder of cybernetics, the study of how the brain talks to itself and how machines can mimic those processes, he was first known as his father's experiment. Leo Wiener insisted that Norbert was born with an average mind, but he believed that with enough willpower and rigorous training, he could shape his son into a genius. Leo was a Russian Jew born in Białystok in present-day Poland, who sought success in America through his extraordinary gift for languages. He could reportedly speak 30 languages well. Despite rising to become a professor of Slavic languages at Harvard, the first of its kind in America, Leo longed for greater acclaim, an unfulfilled ambition he projected onto his son. Norbert's parents named him after a character from a Robert Browning play. Looking back, he reflected that giving him such an unusual name was part and parcel of a decision which they had already made to direct and to channel my life in every detail. His mother, Berta, taught him to read when he was 3 years old. Learning to read at such a young age and the continuous strain of reading under his father's strict supervision later on took a toll on Norbert's eyesight, with serious repercussions in the years to come. Although Leo wasn't heavily involved in his son's education at first, his presence loomed large. Norbert recalled hearing his father work at his desk, noting that the low timbre of the male voice was in itself enough to scare me. As a child, Norbert was extremely sensitive, easily startled, a trait exacerbated by his father's harsh teaching methods. His parents had enrolled him in an elementary school in Cambridge, Massachusetts when he was 7, and he skipped to the 4th grade. But he struggled with arithmetic, finding repetitive drills tedious. So Leo pulled him out of school, deciding to teach him algebra, believing it would be more intellectually stimulating. At first, his father started lessons in a conversational tone, but this lasted until I made the first mathematical mistake. Then the gentle and loving father was replaced by the Avenger of the Blood. The first warning he gave me of my unconscious delinquency was a very sharp and aspirated, "What?" And if I did not follow this by coming to heel at once, he would admonish me, "Now do this again." By this time, I was weeping and terrified. Father was raging, I was weeping, and my mother did her best to defend me, although hers was a losing battle. Leo would scold him, calling him a fool or a donkey, and would repeat these criticisms over dinner. At 9 years old, Norbert enrolled in a high school as a special student, as his father could no longer homeschool him due to the added responsibilities of translating Tolstoy's works into English, in addition to his teaching at Harvard. Yet, no matter how busy he was, Leo Wiener ensured that Norbert recited his lessons every evening. Success was met with a half-hearted, "All right," or, "Very good, you can go and play now." But mistakes were met with a harsh reprimand. As Norbert recalled, failure was punished, if not by blows, by words that were not very far from blows. At age 11, Leo decided that Norbert should enroll at Tufts College rather than Harvard, partly to avoid the public attention that would come with such a young boy attending a prestigious university. He majored in math and also enjoyed chemistry and physics, but socially he felt out of place. "I was not so much a mixture of child and man as wholly a child for purposes of companionship, and nearly completely a man for purposes of study." After completing his bachelor's degree in 3 years, Norbert began graduate studies in zoology at Harvard at the age of 14. He crossed paths with another famous child prodigy, William James Sidis, whose tragic life I've covered in another video linked in the description. Because of Norbert's poor eyesight, he struggled in the lab. His father insisted he switch paths and apply for a scholarship at the Sage School of Philosophy at Cornell. He later described his time at Cornell as the black year of my life. Barely a teenager among classmates in their mid-20s, he didn't fit in. Following his father's strict vegetarian diet, uncommon then, further set him apart. It was also during this time that Norbert made a surprising discovery that he was Jewish. "I was shocked," he recalled. His parents had concealed their heritage, fearing the social and professional disadvantages that came with being part of a persecuted minority. Norbert admitted to harboring anti-Semitic feelings himself, confessing, "I could not accept myself as a person of any value." These sentiments would fade with time. Adding further injury to his sense of self, Leo publicly dismissed Norbert's achievements, attributing them solely to his own teaching methods. In an interview, he stated, "I am convinced that it is the training to which we must attribute the results secured with them. It is nonsense to say, as some people do, that Norbert and Norbert's sisters Constance and Berta are unusually gifted children. They are nothing of the sort. If they know more than other children of their age, it is because they have been trained differently. The public statement deeply hurt Norbert. When this was written down in ineffaceable printer's ink, it had a devastating effect on me. It declared to the public that my failures were my own, but my successes were my father's. His father also tried to mold his younger brother Fritz into a child prodigy, but Fritz's frail health prevented him from enduring the same rigorous training. When Norbert's fellowship at Columbia wasn't renewed, Leo intervened once more, pushing him to transfer to Harvard's graduate school to study philosophy. At 18 years old, Norbert graduated with a dissertation on mathematical logic, a field then considered a branch of philosophical inquiry. He was deeply depressed during this time, describing his life as walking through a dark tunnel. But what came next lifted him out of depression and shaped his future. Norbert received a fellowship to study at the University of Cambridge, where he learned from two of the greatest minds of his time, the philosopher, logician, and mathematician Bertrand Russell, and renowned mathematician G.H. Hardy. During this period, he came to a profound realization. The effective mathematician is likely to be a powerful factor in changing the face of society. Following Russell's advice, Norbert continued his studies in advanced mathematics at Göttingen University in Germany under the legendary David Hilbert. Later, he completed another fellowship at Columbia University, though he found it less intellectually stimulating compared to his time in Europe. In 1915, Norbert returned to Harvard as a temporary instructor in a freshman philosophy course and another in logic, surrounded by students who were his own age. Reflecting on this time, he wrote, "I was now a breadwinner in the full sense, in that I had begun to have a certain stature in my own right." Though he had begun to assert his independence, his father's influence still lingered. When Norbert struggled to find a job for the following academic year, exacerbated by the outbreak of World War I, his father insisted he look for a role in mathematics rather than philosophy. Reluctantly, Norbert turned to a teacher's agency, an organization that helped educators find positions. He found it humiliating that he couldn't rely on academic reputation alone. He eventually accepted a position as an instructor of mathematics at the University of Maine, but found the environment lacking the intellectual stimulation he craved. When America entered the war in 1917, he hoped to serve his country and joined an army training camp to become an officer, only to be rejected due to his poor eyesight after struggling with firearms training. Instead, he contributed to the war effort as a civilian, working at the General Electric factory in Lynn, Massachusetts, as an apprentice engineer in the turbine department. Leo believed Norbert wasn't suited for engineering because he was clumsy, and through his connections, helped his son secure a position as a staff writer for Encyclopedia Americana. Norbert found it refreshing, later saying that these everyday experiences had for me a glamour and a novelty which they would not have had for a boy of more usual bringing up. Just as he was settling into a new rhythm, an urgent telegram arrived from mathematician Oswald Veblen. Veblen asked Norbert to join the ballistic staff at the Proving Ground in Aberdeen, Maryland. The military was developing new artillery and ammunition that required updated range tables, charts predicting how far artillery shells would travel at various angles of elevation. Traditional methods of calculating these tables were too slow for modern warfare, so skilled mathematicians were desperately needed to operate computing machines capable of complex calculations. Surrounded by colleagues who shared his passion for mathematics, Norbert's enthusiasm for intellectual life was reignited. After the war, Professor Veblen informed him of a promising opportunity. MIT was seeking mathematicians, fueled by the post-war boom in industrialization, technological innovation, and scientific research. MIT marked the beginning of a new chapter, one that led to his groundbreaking work on Brownian motion. In 1827, the Scottish botanist Robert Brown observed pollen grains jittering in water, a phenomenon later explained by Einstein, who proved that their random movement resulted from collisions with even smaller molecules. Norbert used probability theory to mathematically model this motion, known as the Wiener process. His model captured three defining characteristics of Brownian motion. Random, the movement is unpredictable, with each step determined by chance. Continuous, the path is smooth and unbroken despite its constant zigzagging. Time-based, the position changes as time passes, with patterns emerging over longer periods. All three behaviors occur simultaneously. This graph depicts a one-dimensional Wiener process, illustrating Brownian motion with its continuous, random fluctuations over time. But this concept isn't limited to microscopic particles. Stock prices often resemble the unpredictable, zigzagging path of Brownian motion. Understanding Brownian motion helps investors gauge a stock's potential volatility and estimate the range of prices it may reach over time. As Norbert's career flourished at MIT, so did his personal life. He met Margaret Engemann, a young immigrant from Germany whose brother happened to be one of Norbert's students. Their connection grew and they eventually married. Norbert dedicated his autobiography to Margaret, to my wife, under whose gentle tutelage I first knew freedom. For a man whose childhood had been shaped by control and expectation, Margaret's love offered him a freedom he had never known. He spent the rest of his career at MIT, over 40 years, until he retired in 1960. Yet his time at the university was not without moral dilemmas. As his colleague Dirk Strauch later observed, he saw and felt things for which most of us were blind and unfeeling. I think this was partly due to the overly strict upbringing he had as a child prodigy. When the US dropped the atomic bomb on Hiroshima, Strauch recalled Wiener's reaction. I well remember how upset he was the day after Hiroshima was bombed. When I remarked that because of Hiroshima, the war against Japan should now come to a speedy close without much further bloodshed, a common sentiment at the time and the official justification still heard today, he replied that the explosion signified the beginning of a new and terrifying period in human history, in which the great powers would prove bound to push nuclear research to a destructive potential never dreamed of before. He also recognized and detested the racism and arrogance displayed in using the bomb against Asians. Wiener spent the war predicting the flight paths of enemy aircraft using mathematical models with feedback loops, adjusting calculations in real time based on new information. He soon realized feedback wasn't just a military tool, it was a universal principle. This insight led to his most groundbreaking work, Cybernetics. Cybernetics is the study of communication and control in both biological and mechanical systems. It examines how systems process information, self-regulate, and adapt to their environment through feedback loops, where a system's output circles back as input to tweak its behavior. A thermostat senses the room's temperature, compares it to the desired setting, and adjusts heating or cooling to maintain balance. In the human body, the brain receives sensory input, processes it, and directs functions like breathing. In robots and AI, feedback loops help machines learn from their actions and improve performance over time. By drawing parallels between the brain's neural networks and the circuit of machines, he laid the foundation for modern fields like artificial intelligence, computer science, and automation. Wiener acknowledged his father's influence on his career, stating, "I have chosen for the work of my later years the study of communication and communication apparatus. This is a subject with linguistic and philological sides which I have learned from my father." The man who caused Norbert the greatest pain was also the one who laid the foundation for his greatest success. Norbert never believed that his father truly saw him as an average mind whom he molded into a genius. Instead, he saw Leo's statements as a way to keep his ego in check, to curb my self-conceit and cut me down to family size. Norbert rejected the idea that genius could be created from nothing. So you can make your child a genius, can you? Yes, as you can make a blank canvas into a painting by Leonardo, or a ream of clean paper into a play by Shakespeare. My father could give me only what my father had, his sincerity, his brilliance, his learning, and his passion. These qualities are not to be picked up on every street corner. Leo projected his own desire for recognition onto his son. Despite being a respected linguist and philologist, Leo felt that his colleagues never saw his work as truly revolutionary. Norbert recognized this struggle. I could perceive at the same time the agony of my father and his need for approval. Norbert raised his two daughters differently, refusing to bring them up in the same strict way. Despite the struggles of his early years, Norbert seemed to have made peace with his past, viewing his later accomplishments as far more significant. The question of the success or failure of my adolescence and post-adolescence has become unimportant to me as to everybody else through the larger issues developed during my career as a working scholar. If Norbert Wiener's discoveries have inspired you to deepen your understanding of math or explore related fields like computer science, data science, or AI, Brilliant is the perfect place to start. Instead of passively watching lessons, Brilliant makes learning interactive. You'll actively solve problems, helping you truly grasp concepts like algebra, calculus, and vectors in a hands-on way. You can also learn to program by diving into Python, where you can start building programs from day one using their built-in drag-and-drop editor. One of my favorite courses are Brilliant's AI offerings, including how large language models work, which breaks down how AI chatbots like Grok, ChatGPT, and DeepSeek actually work. No matter what you choose, Brilliant helps you think critically and improve your problem-solving skills with every lesson. Whether you're just starting out or looking to improve on what you already know, there's something to meet you at your level. And the best part? You can try Brilliant for free for 30 days by signing up using my link, brilliant.org/newsthink, or by scanning the QR code on your screen. That's brilliant.org/newsthink for a free 30-day trial, plus get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Thanks for watching. For Newsthink, I'm Cindy Pom.